Welcome to The Secrets of Success. By following the proven techniques of the guests who appear on this series, you'll learn that even successful people run into detours and failures, and how you can apply their success techniques to change your life.
You're now listening to the most unique show on radio, the show dedicated to making you a success. Dr. BJ Fogg says, change is easy if you make it tiny. Let's find out how. Dr. Fogg, thanks for being with us today.
Hi, Bill. Thank you for inviting me.
Dr. Fogg, you begin your book, the title of which is Tiny Habits, and you say there's a painful gap between what people want and what they actually do. Can you talk about that? Why is that?
Well, so many of us in our lives, we want to sleep better, we want to eat differently, we want to exercise more, and so on. But what most people haven't been given yet is a practical, realistic way of achieving those outcomes. And so we have this gap between what we want and how to get there. And in a big way, that's what Tiny Habits is all about, is filling that gap. Here's how you achieve pretty much any aspiration that you have.
Is this our fault, or is it just that we haven't found the right method, and that's what you write about in your book?
Yeah, it's the second. You know, too often people blame themselves, and it's really painful to see that happen, where they, you know, leave some hype on a commercial or something in a blog post, or just on their own. They're like, this is the year that I'm going to work out for an hour a day. And then they don't succeed, and then they blame themselves for lacking willpower or motivation, which is not helpful. What they should do instead is understand that they just didn't have the right way to bring fitness or nutrition or what have you into their life. So one of the big things in my work now is to help people see that your previous, maybe we'll call them failures, were not your fault. You just didn't have the best way to achieve those outcomes.
And when you say your work, we want our audience to know you actually founded the Behavioral Design Lab, if I'm correct, at Stanford University. Is that correct?
Yeah, I'm a behavior scientist, and I've run a research lab at Stanford for 20 years. In the last 10 years, we've focused really specifically on human behavior and especially habits. And in addition to that, starting in 2011, I started coaching people personally in this new way to create habits that is called Tiny Habits now. And 200 to 300 people a week, week after week, month after month, until I stopped counting at 40,000 people. So I personally coached over 40,000 people. So I have academic research on one hand, and then real world massive experience helping all these people create habits. And I bring that together in Tiny Habits for the first time.
And our audience tonight is getting it for free. So we're the lucky ones because you coach people, you do this at a college, people take your course, but we're getting it for free, and we're going to get to be familiar with your book, Tiny Habits. And hopefully a lot of our listeners will be jumping out and jumping into the reader group that follows your advice and begins to change their life. Why in this age, when there's so much information around, are most of us still stuck in habits that we just continually do? And as you said, even though we say we want to lose 10 pounds, we do nothing about it, or our diet lasts 2 days, or it'll go from January 2nd to January 5th, and then those resolutions go out the window.
You know, with all the information around us, you would think, if you believe sort of the traditional wisdom, or if you thought we're completely logical, that information would lead to change. It would be super healthy and would have plenty of money and would have great relationships. But as it turns out, information alone doesn't lead to lasting behavior change. And so often people want to believe that, and even experts, whether it's your doctor or whether it's your financial planner, they assume if my client or my patient just had the facts, then they would change. But in reality, it's not the facts, it's not data, it's not information alone that leads to change. So when we believe that assumption, either on our own or a professional who thinks it's just an education problem, it's just an awareness problem, they're actually being naive about how lasting change really works.
I think that's a great point. I'm going to repeat it for our audience. information alone does not lead to change. So we may know that we should lose 10 pounds, stop smoking, or start exercising, but knowing it and doing it, two different things, and that's why we need your advice, right?
Well, yeah, and hopefully people recognize that, you know, there probably was a time when they thought, okay, I'm gonna wear this thing that tracks my steps, or I'm gonna, you know, read up about nutrition advice or whatever, and it didn't translate to you actually changing. That's normal. It's not like a character flaw. And what you need is to figure out what specific behavior is the right behavior for you. And I lead people through in Tiny Habits step by step how to figure out what is exactly the right new habits for you, and then how to make those a reality in your life. So even though, yes, I'm a behavior scientist and the aspirations for my lab are really big, what we learned really early, and this would be even 20 years ago, is that simplicity changes behavior. And what you need to do is be very specific about what's the behavior, how do you make it really simple, and how do you do other things to design it into your life.
I'm just writing that down. That's another great quote. Simplicity changes behavior. So I think already our audience is hearing that if they're tired of failing at what they're doing or dropping off that diet or the exercise program, they're definitely listening to the right show, and they better recommend it to their husband, their wife, their children, their brothers and sisters. Now, again, your method is so easy.
Well, yeah, by design. You know, that's what I learned is the insight. And once you hear it, it's kind of obvious, but just really embracing that fact that it is – that we don't reliably bring hard behaviors into our life. That's, you see that on TV shows and you read about that in magazines, but that's why those are on TV, because it's so rare that somebody makes these huge dramatic change. What really works reliably and what anybody has access to is making these tiny changes, which will add up to a big transformation in your life if you pick the right ones and wire them in a very specific way.
Now, I'm going to say personally, whenever we have a guest on, I start preparing the show. I kind of look at whatever that guest is explaining or promoting, and I say, does this really work? Does it just sound nice that if we drink milk, we will be smarter, or if we eat more spinach or something like that? And I myself have found if I start the day off doing a few small tasks, even if I'm just organizing my paper clips or going through the mail, I'll get more done, I'll get things started, and I will pick up, I'll build momentum. If I don't do this, if I start out with something minimal or useless, you know, watching a TV show or reading a comic book or something silly like that, I'm not going to be going ahead with anything useful or beneficial to the rest of the world. So your theory certainly works for me, and I hope it'll work for our audience. Early on in your book, you mentioned three things for successful habits. Could you tell us what those three things are?
Yeah, so there are three ways to change your behavior in the long term. Two of them work, one of them does not.
Okay.
So what doesn't work, I'll start with that, is to have an epiphany. So yes, there are people who have epiphanies, but we can't design them for ourselves or the people. An epiphany where you just see the world differently and you just have different motivations, you just process. In the Bible, you have the story of Saul and Paul as, you know, an epiphany, and that man changed. Too often, people think that if they will have these epiphanies and they'll change, or doctors think, oh, a cancer diagnosis will change this person's behavior. And the surprise is it doesn't do it very reliably. So take epiphany off the table. They happen, but we can't reliably design for them. What we can design for are the next two. One is to redesign your environment, the context, what's around you, and to make good behaviors easier to do. So if you want to eat differently, then surround yourself with the foods that you want to be eating, get rid of the bad ones. Redesigning your environment also means maybe, and this is harder, not hanging out with people who are bad influences on you. So if you have somebody, let's say you're a student, or your friends always, you're living in a dorm that's a party dorm. Well, guess what? It's going to be really hard to study. But if you move to the honors dorm, then with people around you studying, then you are more likely to study. So changing your environment is an effective way. The third way is to make these small, tiny, incremental changes and wire them in as new habits. And in tiny habits, I talk about that, but I also talk about changing your environment, how to redesign that. And those two together work very powerfully.
Dr. Fogg, I want to take a second to remind our audience that if they just tuned in, they're listening to The Secrets of Success on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. I'm your host, Bill Horan, and today we're talking to Dr. BJ Fogg, author of the book Tiny Habits. Dr. Fogg, can you tell us where we can get this book and if there's a website that we can learn more about it?
Good, terrific. Well, I'll give you the order of preference. If there's an independent bookseller near you, walk in and buy the book. Support that store. After that, other physical bookstores. I'm a huge fan of supporting that, and they're being challenged by online sales. If that doesn't work for you, you've got Costco. You've got airports. It's kind of a thrill to walk there, and there's my book in the airport. And then you've got places you can buy it online, of course. And if you want to learn more, tinyhabits.com, where you can learn more about my methods. And in fact, there's a free 5-day program. This is what I started offering in 2011. I'm still offering that. So if you can't afford essentially the $17 for the book, do the free 5-day program. I've got coaches that I've trained that will coach you personally in tiny habits. And I just love off. It's been so great to offer that. Yes, it's taken a ton of my time because I did most of the coaching through the years. The 40,000 people, that was me. No payment, no motive other than trying to help people and then really figure out how to help people create habits. That program's still there, and you go to tinyhabits.com to sign up for that.
And Dr. Fogg, we want to thank you for that information and also remind our audience that you've actually tested this approach on over 40,000 people that you've worked with. You have a lab at a top university that you do this with. And I think I actually read in your book that you actually practiced this yourself and lost 20 pounds. Is that correct?
Yeah. I look at my life and I am not the kind of person that naturally creates habits. I'm a person that likes improvising. I'm a person that likes spontaneity. And so to figure out the tiny habits method, which I did in 2009 and 2010 and apply it to myself, it wasn't natural. It was very deliberate. It was like figuring it out. But I think and it did transform my life. So I'm now 56. I surf every morning when I'm in Maui, when I'm in California, I work out. I'm at the weight I was in college. I feel really good about my fitness, my financial stability, on and on and on. And tiny habits help me achieve those things. But what I point out just briefly in the book, and let me expand on it here. If you wanted to learn music, you wouldn't go to Mozart to have him teach you music. If you wanted to learn to be an artist, you wouldn't go to Picasso. You want to learn from somebody who's been there, who's struggled, and who's figured it out, like was in your position. And that's when I look back, it's like, yeah, that's where I was. I didn't know how habits worked. I wasn't a natural at habits. I figured it out very deliberately. And I think that, and then I taught tons of people, and that together helps me empathize and have compassion for people who are struggling with their habits, but it also helps me teach how to do this in a practical way. And in a way where you feel good, not bad. It's not about guilt. It's not about shame. It's not about willpower. None of those things are part of tiny habits. You change best by feeling good. And that surprises people.
Now, Dr. Fogg, let's take two things. Most of us, either we have a habit we want to develop. Let's say go to the gym once or twice a week. Or we have something we want to stop doing, eating 6 cookies after dinner. Or that snack before dinner, and maybe we would be like you in keeping our weight in the right zone. Should we look at these situations from the positive? I mean, is there a better way to go do something positive and maybe eliminate the cookies to begin with, not even bring them in the house? Or is it to look at the negative habit and correct that?
Well, you're right on target to call those out as two different things. So you have habits you want to form and habits you want to either get rid of or reduce. And you can use tiny habits for both of those things. Both of those come down to, you have a prompt. How easy or hard is it to do and your level of motivation, but you use those things differently. What is far easier to do in most cases is to start new habits. It's pretty straightforward how you do that, and tiny habits is such a simple and direct way of creating new habits. There's some habits are really easy to stop. Let's say you already have the habit of going to the gym an hour a day. Well, you can stop that pretty easily, but that's not what people are talking about when they talk about breaking bad habits. So those kinds of persistent habits that have to do with social media use or procrastinating or eating snacks or maybe smoking or things that are even more serious, those are the kinds of things that people are thinking about, of course. And yes, you can untangle those unwanted habits, but frankly, starting new ones is much easier than untangling those persistent unwanted behaviors.
So start new. That's the key?
Well, it depends. So in tiny habits, I don't know, Bill, if you saw the appendix. Sometimes people read the book and they don't go to the appendix. In the appendix, I have a very detailed flowchart for three phases of how do you untangle unwanted habits. And there's really three phases. And we're talking here not just about simple habits, but the more complicated ones that you've really worked on. And phase one is to focus on creating new habits. So set aside the snacking habit. You know, don't worry about that for now. Instead, get good at creating new snacking habits. Don't worry about the 6 cookies after dinner or the 3 a.m. cake or the soda during lunch. In phase two, once you've learned how to create new habits, in phase two, then you start looking at the habit that you want to untangle. And there's a systematic way to do that. And usually those two things together will resolve the problem. If not, then you go to phase three, which is where you deliberately swap in a good habit for the unwanted habit. Now, that comes in phase three. A lot of people will say that's the only way to do it. That's not true. That comes at the very end of the process if the previous phases didn't resolve the problem.
Now, tiny habits, one of the things you say about it, it allows you to start now, which I think all of us get to that point. Someday the pants don't fit or the dress or the outfit or, some event in life says to us, you got to lose a few pounds. You're starting to uncomfortable, blah, blah, blah. So can you give us the essence of a tiny habit approach, how you would recommend to that person? And since so many of us are involved with weight, if you want to use that or exercise, give us a real life example.
I'm going to use a real example, but not weight. I think that gets treated a lot, but you can apply it to weight and nutrition, of course. Let's pick reading more, because a lot of people aspire to that. Read more books. So you take a new habit that you want. Don't pick one that you feel like you should have. So if you feel like, oh, I should be reading more, guess what? Scrap that. Pick something you want to do. And a lot of people do want to read more. And then you make it really specific and really tiny. So it's like, okay, I'm going to read more in this book, but you don't even set yourself up for one chapter. Maybe it's one paragraph a day. So you scale it back to be super tiny. Then you find, where does reading one paragraph fit naturally into my existing routine? Maybe it comes after you start the coffee maker. Maybe it comes after you sit down on the subway on your way to work. What you're trying to do is plant this new habit seed, where it will fit naturally in your life. And that's, I can make suggestions, but everybody's routines are different. So that's part of the designing of the habit into your life, find where it fits. And then once you find where it fits, then start practicing that new habit with, and this is going to surprise people, as you open the book and read the paragraph, you do this thing in tiny habits we call celebration. You reinforce the behavior. You cause yourself to feel a positive emotion as you open the book or as soon as you finish the paragraph by going, and in my case, one of my go-to celebrations is I'll do this fist pump. You can't see me doing it, but imagine that I'm like Tiger Woods doing a fist pump and I go, awesome. Or I might go, way to go, BJ. That sounds crazy, but what you're doing by causing yourself to feel a positive emotion, you are having your brain connect the reading habit to this positive emotion. Your brain goes, wow, that felt good. So you're deliberately hacking your brain to wire this habit in. So you've got those three pieces in tiny habits. Pick what you want, make it really simple. find where it fits naturally, and then wire in the habit through celebration.
We want to find out more about this, BJ, but I want to stop and let our audience know, if you're just tuning in and say, who's this guy coming up with these great ideas? Our guest today is Dr. BJ Fogg. He's the author of the book, Tiny Habits. BJ, can you tell us where the book is available and if there's a website where we can learn more?
You should be able to find Tiny Habits at all your local booksellers, Costco included, and you can buy it online, of course. And tinyhabits.com has more information about the method there. And if you want to find out about me more broadly, bjfogg.com.
And again, to our audience, the show is The Secrets of Success. I'm your host, Bill Horan. And I want to remind you, if you like what you hear, or if you say, gee, I wish my husband, my son, my sister could hear this, you can go to nccradio.org. That's nccradio.org. Just scroll down and look for Secrets of Success. And then you want the show that's entitled Tiny Habits. You can listen to it at your leisure. You can listen to it over and over, and then go out and get a copy of the book, Tiny Habits, and make it a part of your life. Dr. Fogg, you've mentioned, I wrote a quote from your book, that the single most important skill in behavior change is feeling successful. Can you talk about that and tell us how we can do that? Because a lot of us just don't feel successful.
Yeah, you know, this can change so much for people who open their minds and their hearts to this. As it turns out, repetition is not what creates habits. That's in the headlines. You'll read that. That's not the case. If you look at the research that people cite, repetition correlates with habit strength, but there's no data in those studies that show that it actually causes it to form. What causes it is the emotion you feel, the how your brain associates the expect, like, oh, wow, if I take a drink of water, I'm going to feel awesome. If I play this video game, I'm going to feel relief. So it's the emotional connection that your brain has with that behavior. That's what wires in the habit. And so if you want to be really good at forming habits, you get really good at the technique that in Tiny Habits we call celebration, and that's something you do to cause a positive emotion on demand. Now, I talked previously about my Tiger Woods fist pump and saying, awesome, or you can raise your hand and go, way to go, or give yourself a high five. I mean, there's over at least 100 ways to celebrate. And in the appendix of Tiny Habits, I list those. The key is people need to find what celebrations work for you, what celebrations genuinely help you feel like you're succeeding. And once you know what that is, then you can do that at the moment of the behavior in order to help rewire your brain and create the habit. Now, this is a radically different approach to creating habits than people have ever heard before. So some people are probably pretty skeptical. But when you look at how do you help reinforce your kids' behaviors, your pet behaviors, and so on, what do video games do to get you to keep playing? Well, they're like, good job, and they're giving you points. So once you understand that it's emotions that wire habits into our brain and into our life, and then you can actually hack it through celebration, when you have that skill of being able to celebrate and fire off a positive emotion on demand, then you have a superpower for creating habits. And that, of the 30-some-odd skills that I talk about in the book, that one is the most important. Because if you can do that, man, you can wire in habits fast. So that I realize in my book that's probably going to be one of the most controversial areas. But the people who have put it into practice, the thousands of people I've coached, they just find it remarkable how effective it is, surprising, and also fun because they discovered this power they didn't know they could even create.
You know, as you answer that question, I'm just thinking every commercial I see on TV basically uses that. Let's say they're selling a soft drink, Coke or Pepsi. Well, what do we see? We see young people and handsome and pretty people. They go into a restaurant, they drink, they look happy, they're laughing. Other friends come up to them. Everything is good about their life. They're enjoying it. They seem to be attracting one another, so they're making good relationships. And all is good in their world. So I think all of the products out there basically sell us that product based on the emotion that we're going to be happier, we're going to be more attractive, we're going to be richer someday, or at least look richer, etc. Now, we've heard that expression, you can't teach an old dog new tricks. What about all us old dogs out there? Does this work for someone over 50, 60, 70?
Yes, guess what? Good news is that's not true. One of my friends here in Maui, she's 91 years old, and she has used Tiny Habits in her life. And now that I was able to give her the book about a month ago, she's applying it more and more. So certainly, my friend Dorothy in her 90s can create new habits, and she's just delighted because she's discovering, branching out in a way at the stage in her life she never expected. So that old dogs, new tricks. You know why it's harder, or people think it's harder for older people to change, is because we're usually more set in where we live and who our friends are and so on. So it's our contexts that are quite stable, whereas if you're a student, where you live changes, your friendships might change and so on. So it's because of the changing environment. We talked about this early on, that environment really controls our behavior and habits in a big way. And so if you are moving from place to place, then you open the door to change. Now, that has nothing to do with age directly. It's just that college students happen to move around a lot and your friends change, whereas when you get more stable, it's, your context is a little more settled. So it's not age that's changing it, it's the environment. So back to the earlier point about redesign your environment and get good at redesigning your environment, and that's part of making lasting change.
Now, you have an easy system, and you call it the anatomy of tiny habits, and I think you call it the ABC system. Could you tell us what ABC stands for?
Yeah, and it wasn't designed to be ABC. It just happened that way. So as a scientist, I am suspicious and skeptical, and I mean, that's what you do. You know, it's like, what's the evidence? So whenever there's a clever acronym, I'm always like, I'm a little suspicious. So this just happened. But ABC stands for this, anchor. The anchor is the thing that reminds you to do the new habit. So if flossing is the new habit you want, the anchor probably could be brushing. So you use brushing as your anchor to remind you to floss. So the B is behavior. So anchor, behavior. Behavior is the thing you want to become the new habit. And the idea is you're attaching that behavior, you're anchoring it to something stable. So after I brush, I will floss. In this case, you make it really tiny. One tooth, not all your teeth, just one. And then the C stands for celebration. So ABC is anchor, behavior. Behavior is the thing you want to create a habit out of. And then celebration, that's the thing to self-reinforce, to wire the habit into your brain.
Dr. Fogg, I know our audience, and I want to warn them, if they see me walking down the street and giving the fist pump or jumping up and down the air, I'm just following your good advice. Before we wrap up today, one more time, give us that website.
You can go to tinyhabits.com to learn more, join the five-day program. There's a free toolkit PDF you can download right away. I've tried to make this as approachable and available to as many people as I can.
And again, for our audience, our guest has been BJ Fogg, spelled F-O-G-G. The book is Tiny Habits. Go out, develop some of these habits, and jump on that road to success. We want our audience to know that you've been listening to The Secrets of Success on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. I'm your host, Bill Horan, asking you to please join us again next week at the same time when we will continue our journey to success.